Hey guys, welcome back to our continuing coverage of the Chicago Comic and Entertainment Expo right here from Podcast Central. We have got an incredibly special guest here in the booth. Guys, you know him from Descender, Ascender, many other titles, Mr. Dustin Nguyen. How's it going, man?
Great, man.
Big round of applause. We've already got a crowd, and I'm only like two sentences in right now. So, man, number one, right off the bat, how's the con going?
It's great. I haven't been back here in, I think, like 3 or 4 years. And everything's changed when I got back. So
yeah, well, if you'll indulge me for just a second.
Yeah, it's a great show.
We first met you in New York Comic Con in 2000, I want to say it was 18 maybe. And it absolutely, we didn't have this whole setup, but, yeah. But my wife Shauna and I, who's taking photos and videos right there, we went over to your booth at New York Comic Con, and it was a religious experience to stand at your booth. First of all, you're the nicest guy I'd ever met.
Insanely nice guy.
I take it really well.
Just to be able to pick up those original watercolor pieces from Descender and actually thumb through them just absolutely blew my mind.
Thanks so much.
So huge thanks for being so awesome. My first question, I know these guys have a lot of questions. They're massive fans.
Oh, don't get me started.
The transition from Descender to Ascender. How far into Descender did you guys know that you were going to continue the series into what's now a completely different but totally awesome book?
Yeah, it's really hard to say because Jeff and I, the way we work is we let the book, it kind of develops organically. Jeff would write like, you know, 5 issues at a time, and he'll write it all, and then you know, I start drawing it, and then we kind of like fill out the book, see where it's going, and we kind of like go wherever it leads. And with the transition into Ascender was that one issue where Driller fell into the magic planet, that's what I call it.
Sad issue.
Yeah, but you know, he goes there, and then we're like, you know, we could really do more with this. Let's do so. It kind of just happens organically, and then we're like, you want to keep drawing, and that's the best part about like owning your own property is like you can do whatever the hell you want, whenever you want. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So yeah.
Does that mean that you literally have no idea how many of these you're going to have to illustrate?
No. We plan it out because we have to plan our life out.
Okay.
So yeah. We kind of plan out, you know, far enough where we don't tie ourselves down, you know?
Sure.
So if you asked us last month, like, hey, how many issues do you think you're doing? I would say one thing. You ask me next month. We're like, you know, it actually feels pretty good. We might go a little more or we might go a little less, but it really depends on when we want to. Like, it's the same thing with our page count. Some issues are 20 pages. Some issues are like 32 pages.
Yeah.
And the way we work, I'm like, dude, Jeff, just write whatever you need to make a story that we can tell that's the way you want it.
Yeah.
That's good enough, you know, like if you need an extra 5 pages, do it, you know. And when he turns in the script, he, you know, I look at it and he's like, you know, if you feel like you need to take anything out, you feel like you can achieve it with this much or that much more, do it. And it's the beauty of like true creator ownership, you know.
So I mean, how did the Descender universe come? I mean, were you friends with Jeff long before? Is this something you guys have been hashing out long before?
We knew each other from just Comic-Con, just meeting each other, you know, at panels, and you know, we kind of had passed by, but we both worked at Vertigo, so we kind of had like that connection. And Jeff was he was wrapping up his contract with DC at the time, and I was too, and we were both like 13-15 years into DC. So I mean, right off the bat, when you work with someone that has that kind of track record, it's always on time, this, you know, it gives you more confidence, like, hey, I can do a creator own book with this guy and not worry about, you know, starving or, you know, not having stuff to draw. And I'm pretty sure he saw the same way. And we're both like, you know, we both have families and mortgages. So that's the key issue, man. When you got rent to pay, that's the biggest motivation.
Tell me about it.
That's the deadline.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Descender is something I recommend to absolutely everyone. We've been to many free comic book days and, you know, mothers bring their children and stuff like that. And they come to us because they think that we know what we're talking about. And they're like, well, what should I pick up? And the first thing I always say is I give them the trade for Descender and say, look, you're going to love it. Your kid's going to love it. Everybody's going to love it. The designs of the characters in Descender, is this something you have always sort of been sketching? Because, I mean, the weapons are very unique. With the glowing tips and stuff like
they're
that.
Lazy, the robot, aren't they?
I mean, they're great. They're great.
You know, I think it's one of those things where every kid does it. You know, like growing up, I mean, I'm not sure if every kid does, but like, you know, I would say, I don't want to be sexist, but most little boys like drawing guns and blasters and cannons, you know what I mean? And that's what I was into. And I grew up on a lot of like Transformers and Robotech. And the tech that I, like, you know, you mentioned the tech and the designs are really, Jeff and I kind of clicked because we come from a time when technology looked like what they did. Like robots are big and clunky, you know, industrial machines are industrial sized, they're heavy, they're full of gears and stuff like that. You know, which is not to say that today's designs are bad, but it's a little different today with, you know, we have all the touchscreen. Everything is kind of like minimized. You know, everything looks clean and smooth, like, you know.
Driller looks like a drill.
Yeah, Driller. So in that world, we try to, I try to make everything.
Driller, real
look,
killer.
Yeah, yep. Exactly what it does. You know, it's like, it's the way I approach it is like, it's, everything is should be like a brick. A brick does exactly what it is. It's a brick. You know, you could use it as a door stopper, maybe. But.
That's very zen.
We're going to cut that for our show, by the way.
I want to back up for a minute and talk about your art style, because it's unlike anything else, especially with your watercolors. How did you get into that? Because when I was growing up, I loved to draw.
Yeah.
I would never touch watercolors because I'd always make brown. I'd always mix the wrong colors and screw it up. So you know, where did that come from?
It's just I grew up on a lot of like heavy metal magazine. Comics and stuff.
Nice.
And I thought it was the norm back then.
Yeah.
Because before there was, you know, Photoshop, most people did it. Even if it looks like Photoshop, they were still doing it by hand.
Mm-hmm.
They were still laying down colors by hand. Like Alex Sinclair over at Wildstorm, he started that whole Photoshop thing for the entire studio. And even when they were just learning Photoshop, Alex would go in there and I would look at old... He would still go in with markers and lay down colors and everything, you know? So... Growing up, I was, you know, from a time when I was reading a lot of John Muth and, you know, Ken Williams and all the entire roster of, you know, like Mobius and stuff, you know, like, and they all did stuff. And I thought it was the norm and I thought it was pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
And also for me, like when I jumped over to Descender, it was easier, you know, because Photoshop, I love the hell out of digital and Photoshop. But the problem with me is that I love it so much, I'll sit around, I'll just play with the colors all day, moving switches around. Yeah. I was like, this is so great. Next thing you know, it's taking longer because you're just fiddling with it. Then with our pages, like, done is done. You know, like, I have to move on a monthly deadline, and sometimes it scans in, it doesn't look right, but I'm like, you know, done is done.
You color them, you scan them, you're done.
Yeah, I do a few touch-ups, you know what I mean? Okay. I do pump up the saturation a little because it helps a lot.
Okay.
The line work and stuff, for legibility reasons.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, I got to go and clean out. Because when it scans, there's like all kinds of dust, and you should see a clean, first scan page. It looks horrible. It's like there's dust on there, eraser rubbings, and I don't know what the hell's on my scanner.
I'll take it.
Yeah, I was gonna say if you're handing them out, like we'll take some.
I mean, with the Descender style and the fact that when you scan it, you actually see the paper pulp.
Yeah.
You see that? So it almost kind of works.
Yeah, that part I kind of liked it. I like that.
That's a good point.
That paper with Descender, I used a code press, so it had more tooth to it, more texture. With Ascender, I want to do more organic stuff. And for me to come back and do line work, I have to use like a smoother paper, so I use a hot press, which is what I've been using for covers. So it's a lot smoother. It's less forgiving though, because once paint's on, it's on. The other one, if it's on, you can kind of pull it out sometimes if you mess up. So,
do you get to the end of a page and you're like, I don't really love the way I started this first panel, and I got to start the entire thing over again? Or,
I kind of lay out everything first before I start painting it. So the way I do it is I draw the entire book in pencils first, and then I go back and I paint it. Scene by scene, depending on like the lighting for each one, and then when I'm done with that, I bring the whole batch back around. Then I go back with line work. So I'll go back and pencil it again, add, you know, whatever I need to, and then Photoshop brings in, you know, if I need, like you said, the guns, the glows.
Mm-hmm.
It fixes a lot of things. Sometimes the faces are a little wonky. Like sometimes I draw the heads too big.
Mm. I love your Batman heads are perfect, by the way.
Thanks, man. But yeah, like, you know, Photoshop technology helps everything.
Sure.
I mean, start to finish. What's a book take from pencil to paint to Photoshop? I mean,
like time wise.
Yeah, like
you know, it depends on the issue and depends. Like, if you give me 3 months, I'll take 3 months. But if you give me a month, then I guess I got to do it in a month. So
yeah.
It really
no, I can't.
It's like no self control over things. But some issues take a little longer, especially if we're developing new worlds. But you know, when it's a page where it's like characters I'm familiar with. And it's the same thing with DC stuff. Like, when they hand me a cover and they're like, yeah, can you just do a Batman cover? You know, we got like 2 days. I was like, dude, I could do it by tomorrow. They'll say, hey, can you do like a, you know, League of Legion or something?
Mm-hmm.
You got 2 weeks. I was like, dude, I'm going to need like three. Like,
really?
Because you're not comfortable with the characters.
Yeah.
I'm very comfortable in Gotham, but everything else is a little bit of a struggle for me.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
Who in the DC haven't you touched yet that you, artistically speaking, that you might want to actually tackle one day?
There really isn't any, dude. I usually, like, the reason I haven't tackled them probably is because I didn't want to.
Yeah.
DC's been very nice to me. They've offered me, they're like, you know, whatever you want to draw, you got it. You can just ask for it, basically, with DC. And they've been very kind. So if I haven't drawn it yet, it's pretty much because I have no interest in it. So
Please keep drawing Spike from Cowboy Bebop.
Oh my God.
Keep pumping those out, yes. Please.
Good Lord. So we actually last year we talked about Descender being optioned for a movie,
right?
And your loose connection to that, like at least in terms of character design,
right?
So has that advanced at all?
It actually has advanced a lot, but we are not. Actually, it just advanced last week, so without giving anything away, I could say we have some big news coming up.
You know? When? When? Breaking news coming up? Like,
you don't have to tell us what the news is. Yeah. Just tell us when we can expect it.
You know, working with PR right now, so.
Okay.
Yeah. No, I want to do it right.
Can you tell us what studio you're working with?
No, absolutely not. No.
That's
but no,
okay.
It could not be that at all. It could be just like, hey, a big character's coming back. You know.
Okay. So, knowing that there is news is enough for me.
Yeah.
So we appreciate that.
We're on to you.
Well, guys, I don't know if you have anything else. This has been absolutely spectacular.
Dude, thank you.
We
so
just
much,
really
man.
Appreciate your time, Dustin.
No, thanks
thank
for, like, you know, keeping a spot for me. Because I know I was like, oh, I don't know if I can get back here. Because I don't really know, Mike. When I travel, I don't know what my schedule is like, you know, like at the booth or here.
How dare you, Dustin?
I'm sorry.
How dare you?
A little background, Dustin and I were talking via Instagram,
right.
And I asked if he could come by, and he's like, conventions are crazy, of course. And he's like, I'll do my best. And lo and behold, you're here.
He did his best.
He did his best.
No, thank you.
We really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
That says Podcast Central is shining like the sun.
This is
here,
a beautiful
just south
man.
Of Artist Alley. Well, thanks. We can't thank you enough for coming by.
No, thank
we know
you
how crazy you are. Where are you going next? What's your next con stop?
I'll be in Emerald City, Seattle. You guys going to be out there or no?
We're not.
Okay.
Our next stop is going to be Boston Northeast.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
So,
yeah. Next one's Seattle, and then WonderCon and AwesomeCon, and of course San Diego. That's mandatory. So.
Awesome. Well, can't thank you enough, man. You absolutely made our day. Dustin Nguyen, everybody, give him a big round of applause. Shauna.
Thank you.
Hey, Dustin.
You missed some great stuff.
One last question.
Yeah.
Your Big Cartel store, I recommend everyone going to his Big Cartel store for his original artwork. Are you going to do another scavenger hunt? Because I was a lucky winner Christmas time last year.
Oh, right.
When you started posting.
I might, man. The problem I ran into was the site would start, I would only have one piece, and the site would just ring up seven pieces. And then I'd have to go back and apologize to people. Hey, you didn't get that. You weren't the first one.
So he would hide artwork on his Big Cartel store online and be like, I'm putting it at zero.
Huh?
I got one.
Oh,
yeah.
Dude,
I was
great.
The first one to add it to my cart and
what?
Get it, and you shipped it to me. So I have some of his original artwork just from winning it on your Big Cartel store.
That's cool, man.
I'm sitting next
winning.
To a winner. I
got
had no
it.
Idea.
Winning.
I saw that pun.
Well, guys, we got a lot of more amazing Chicago Comic and Entertainment Expo coverage coming up all weekend long. We're going to be here all day tomorrow, so stick around right here on the ChumpCast on the YouTube channel, Chuckload of Comics, and we'll see you here next time. See you around the con floor. Have a fantastic con. See you later.